You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeder. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeder.
It is Monday, August 6, 2018. My name is Sam Steeder. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, does Brett Kavanaugh have a Jim Jordan problem? Jim Jordan does. Kris Kobach's GOP voter fraud lies completely exposed and debunked. Meanwhile, new sanctions regarding Iran start tomorrow, and Alex Jones deplatformed. Meanwhile, Trump Inc. in full court press to let the air out of obstruction charges, and primaries and special elections tomorrow. Dave Rubin, call your office. Data shows left-wingers fired on campus more than right-wingers. And is the NRA going down before the Russia investigation takes it down? DC Transit Union balks at white trains for white supremacists. And Big Steel uses the Trump tariffs to bludgeon smaller competitors. And lastly, the Trump administration has a new Obamacare kneecapper plan. All this and more on today's program, ladies and gentlemen. I am back from Nolens. That's apparently what you call it.
Is that there. How you learned to say it down there?
Yeah, that was it. I went to, there's a learning annex class, and you can call it NOLA or you can call it Nolens.
I actually went to a comedy show when I was down there last, where a comedian did an extended bit on how literally nobody says that.
Nobody says Nolens?
No. If you go, if you find a 100-year-old catfish in a swamp with a mustache, he still won't say Nolens.
That comedian was a liar, because I did meet a guy who said that.
Well.
Me.
I stand corrected.
Down at Netroots Nation, it was a good time. We've got a couple of interviews still in the can, as it were. I had the opportunity to sit down with Chakwe Lumumba, who is the relatively new mayor of Jackson, Mississippi, who vowed to be the most radical mayor in the country when he was elected. And fascinating what's going on there. Interesting conversation. I have a feeling like in 20 years, maybe less, 20 years, people will be voting for him for national office. I have a feeling. I mean, it's...
Competition would start kicking in.
That's right.
For the most radical mayor, that's good competition.
Yeah, exactly. That is a very good a competition. And I had the opportunity to meet a bunch of fans of the program. Sat down with Zephyr Teachout, and that one may end up on Ring of Fire Radio. We may have her in studio. She could be a national figure. I mean, it's fascinating. The Attorney General's office in New York State, probably the first or second most important in the country. Maybe the first. It depends. But just in the same way that California can dictate things like cafe standards for cars. And we should say, as of Friday, I didn't get to this, but Donald Trump's administration is attempting to prevent the state of California from setting its own regulations for emissions from cars, because they are the de facto regulator of emissions in the country. Because if you do not qualify to sell your vehicles in California, which is the fifth largest economy in the world. You can't sell your car. You can't run a car business, essentially, car manufacturer. And so people make cars that are compliant with California, and they just leave it that way for the rest of the world. And the Trump administration wants to stop that.
Hey, so, sometimes you need big government to enforce small government.
That's right. That's right. States' rights, all that. You know what that's about. It was a great time to catch up with a bunch of different folks down at Netroots. It was interesting. You know, there was a real sense that a lot of people, I ran into a lot of people who were in the similarly situated as I. They hadn't been in 2 or 3 years. They were coming back. It's also interesting, and I think, you know, it's hard for me to remember what stuff was on air and what stuff I recorded off air, but that dynamic for Netroots used to be the outsiders versus the insiders. And to a certain extent, it's still that way. But there's also just more ideology that seems to be creeping in. I have a feeling it'll be interesting to see where that heads next year. There's going to be, I would imagine, most of the people running for president will be there next year, at least for seeking the Democratic nomination. Most, I'm not sure all. But there's also, apparently, potential danger that lurks for presidential candidates or would-be presidential candidates who go there. You know, it's funny because I think in like a couple of interviews or conversations I was having with people there, I noted the presence of Palestinian rights advocates, which I hadn't noticed before. And then we saw this picture. I think it was Friday afternoon it was taken. Maybe it was Saturday. But I think we also noted when Cory Booker came into the room and people were getting very excited. And Cory Booker took this picture with some Palestinian rights advocates and perhaps maybe some immigrant rights advocates. And the sign says, from Palestine to Mexico, all the walls have to go. And obviously, the wall that is being referred to in terms of Mexico is the wall that Donald Trump obsessively talks about, the see-through wall. That so it has to be see-through so you can see the drug runners firing those cannons, which shoot the packets of cocaine over the wall so that it doesn't land on your head and you get injured. That, I think, is the official explanation as to why they need to be see-through. And then the Palestinian wall, of course, is the wall that was built in the West Bank, right across Palestinian property, destroying many olive tree fields, I guess you would call them, or I don't know if you would call them forests, but the wall in dividing parts of the West Bank is rather controversial, at least in terms of, you know, it's been longstanding. Well, let me just read this from Cory Booker, because he was apparently the power of right wing pro-Israel money in the Democratic Party has not diminished, perhaps maybe as much as I had hoped. But he released the spokesperson has released the following. Just before delivering a speech in New Orleans, Senator Booker was approached by dozens of people for photos. That is true. In one instance, amid the rush, he was posing for a photo and was passed a sign to hold. He didn't have time to read the sign. And from his cursory glance, he thought it was talking about Mexico and didn't realize anything to do with Israel. He hopes for a day when there'll be no need for security barriers in the state of Israel. But while active terrorist organizations threaten the safety of people living in Israel, security barriers are unfortunate but necessary to protect human lives, said Booker spokesperson Jeff Geitz. Now, look, I don't buy that explanation from Senator Booker, spokesperson. I think that he was perfectly aware of what sign he was holding up. And I think he just got severe pushback from somebody. Maybe it was just somebody. Maybe it was two somebodies. Maybe it was three somebodies. But I don't think it was much more than that. I have a feeling it was like a couple of big donors were very upset. And they walked it back. Now, just to give you a sense of how uncontroversial that sign actually is. And how little, I mean, this is the problem with Booker, right? I mean, this is the problem with Booker. I don't think this is a hill he should die on, the validity of a sign, because it's empty rhetoric anyways. But this is not a controversial position, the idea that you shouldn't be building that wall or you shouldn't have built that wall. Here is a otherwise, I mean, I guess apparently a radical pro-Palestinian rights advocate. Back, I would say now this was probably around 2003, maybe this was 2004, 2001. I don't know. It's almost maybe a decade and a half ago. I don't know exactly when this was. But here he is discussing whether or not Israel should even build this wall in the first place.
Steve. That would be Steve of Reuters.
Would you like to see Israel release the political prisoners, and would you like to see them stop building this barrier wall?
I think, first of all, on the wall, let me talk about the wall. I think the wall is a problem, and I've discussed this with Ariel Sharon. It is very difficult to develop confidence between the Palestinians and the Israel with a wall snaking through the West Bank. And I will continue to discuss this issue very clearly with the prime minister. As I said in my statement today, he has issued a statement saying he's willing to come and discuss that with us. And I appreciate the willingness to discuss it.
Look, when George W. Bush is to the left of you on just about anything, you know you've got a problem. But particularly when it comes to Israel and Israel's security policy. This is an administration that largely many attribute the unleashing of Israel's worst instincts. Because for a long time, America provided a damper on the most self-destructive of Israel's, and not just self-destructive, destructive of others, Israel's impulses. And the Bush administration, widely credited with failing to serve that function for Israel. The idea being that Israel's could, in some respects, always have an excuse that we you know, United States stands between us in allowing Hamas to, you know, to, you know, to, you know, that we shouldn't go on a bombing run in Lebanon or whatnot. I mean, so the idea that George Bush is to the left of a position that Cory Booker, not even a position, a sign that Cory Booker was afraid of holding is a problem.
When they have a meeting, do you think there's a chance that they look at that and say, well, that was a tough situation, but we handled that as well as we could have? So you hold the sign up because you don't want to, like, say, no, I don't want to hold that because of Palestine in that room. And then you get to come back and walk it back later, and you get to basically play it both ways.
Yeah, I don't think it's that sophisticated, because I think it's very easy for a staffer to come up and say, the senator doesn't like to hold signs during pictures. Just let's have you guys in there. The senator doesn't hold signs, just as a policy. I don't even need to read it. It could say USA number one. We don't hold signs. I think he thought what you thought. Like, I'm going to do this because I'm going to show my bona fides. And then he realized, like, his bona fides were getting out in front of him a little too much. Sometimes when your bona fides is showing, it's a little bit embarrassing.
You know, it's hard to keep it straight, which non-American people are humans and which are slightly less than, you know?
That's right. Sometimes it gets very confusing. You just don't know which brown people are we allowed to be okay with and which ones are we not? That can get very difficult to parse. We'll get back to that in a moment, because there is some stuff I want to talk about in terms of Netroots as well. But this was pretty exciting for me, because, you know, as you folks know, I about 2 or 3 years ago, maybe it was maybe a little more, 4 years ago, I got very, I don't want to say obsessive about my dental hygiene. I'm not saying I was ever I'm not saying I didn't brush my teeth, but I just became more aggressive about making sure that I was diligently flossing and brushing properly. Because when you get to be my age, there's all sorts of dental issues that can go wrong. I'm actually, this is an aside, but I'm getting pressured to get those braces because my bite is off.
The invisible ones?
Yeah.
Wow.
A little pricey. But that's secondary. Here's the point. You got to brush your teeth well. And I was very excited to see that a friend of mine, she actually has a quip. I was super excited to see that. I was a little disappointed that it was not purchased with the majority report code. Yep. But she's very sophisticated about design. And so that's why the quip was well placed. The truth is, most of us are brushing our teeth wrong. We don't do it for long enough, and we forget to change our brush on time. That's one of the things that people, Jamie, I'm not singling anybody out, but I'm quite sure that you have not replaced your brush.
You know what happens when we assume.
I know. I understand. Most brands focus on selling flashy gimmicks rather than better brushing, but not Quip. Quip is an electric toothbrush that costs a fraction of the bulkier brushes, and it packs just the right amount of vibrations to clean your teeth. It's got a built-in timer, guiding pulses to help you clean for the full dentist recommended 2 minutes. Quip subscription is built for your health. It delivers new brush heads every 3 months for just $5, including free shipping worldwide. It also comes with a suction cup mount that unsticks to use as a cover for hygienic travel. Everybody loves Quip. Me, my friends, family.
I'm quite fond of it.
Matt. They were on Oprah's O list. They were named one of Time's best inventions and the first subscription electric toothbrush ever accepted by the American Dental Association. They're even backed by a network of over 20,000 dentists and hygienists and hundreds of thousands of happy brushers. Quip starts at just $25. And if you go to getquip.com/majority right now, you'll get your first refill pack free with a Quip electric toothbrush. That's your first refill pack free at getquip.com/majority. I give you a little tube of toothpaste, too. Quip toothpaste. Spelled getquip.com/majority. Getquip.com/majority. Check it out, folks. Also, I just want to remind you, we've gotten some pretty good feedback on this, actually. BetterHelp is affordable, private online counseling. You get unlimited access to licensed, trained, fully accredited therapists. It's perfect for you on your phone and computer through text, voice, or video chat. They're LGBT friendly. They're great for couples counseling. Anything else you're going through in life right now, all you need to do is go to betterhelp.com/majority. You fill out a questionnaire. They match you with a counselor who's perfect for you. You can start counseling today. If you decide you're not vibing with the therapist you're with, you get to change them, no problem. It's less expensive than in-person counseling, but you're still getting the great help from licensed professionals. And if you have trouble affording it, BetterHelp has a financial aid package available. You're always connected to your counselor. You have unlimited access. You can talk to them every day if you want. Connect basically anywhere you're at home, on a computer, at work, theoretically. You're not wasting time traveling to someone's office and sitting around in a waiting room. You can sign up right now, save on quality professional therapy by going to betterhelp.com/majority. Betterhelp.com/majority. All right. One of the people I spoke to at Netroots Nation was the Secretary of State of the state of Connecticut. And I got to be honest with you. I got pitched her, and I think her name off the top of my head was Denise Morrell, I think it was. And, you know, Secretary of State, State of Connecticut, you don't quite doesn't quite have that feel of like this is going to be a dynamic interview. But I got to say, it was really interesting. We will, I believe we'll play it down the road. It'll definitely go on to Ring of Fire. But this was right on the following the news about the one Democratic, there were two Democratic member of the Vote Integrity Commission. You'll recall that Kris Kobach, the Secretary of State of Kansas, set up the Voter Fraud Commission, I guess it was called. Maybe it was called Voter Integrity Commission. And one of the few Democrats, I believe there was two, that was appointed to this to give it some type of bipartisan cover was this guy, Matthew Dunlop. He's the Maine Secretary of State. I guess there was some sense that this guy would be amenable in some way, maybe, to what was going on there. And you probably heard about this. You remember the commission was shut down in January. And it was shut down in January because Dunlop had been basically sequestered and was not allowed to see like secret minutes from the meetings, was not allowed to see the data they had compiled. Because the commission's co-chairs, Mike Pence, we may have heard of, he is the vice president of the United States, and Kris Kobach had claimed that there was widespread fraudulent voting and it was going to require new onerous voting restrictions. And in fact, when the commission closed down because Matthew Dunlop had sued to get his hands on this information that they were supposedly working on, this is what presidential spokesperson Sarah Huckabee Sanders had to say at that time, just to give you a notion, because this is now a testable premise. She's going to give us a sense of what they had found, how unfortunate it is that they had to shut this down. Remember, ostensibly, this was about Donald Trump's claim that 3 to 5 million undocumented immigrants had voted in this election, which is why Hillary Clinton won the popular vote, because it was all illegal immigrants voting illegally, despite the fact that they are risking deportation.
Illegally and unstrategically.
Rather unstrategically. Like, I know, let's all go to California and we'll vote in California, right?
They haven't passed their naturalized citizens test. They don't know about the Electoral College.
That's the big problem. They were sophisticated enough to decide, I'm going to set up this whole voting rig thing. They organized the buses, but then they went to California where the votes were not needed. If
could have taken Utah.
They could have gone. They could have taken Utah. They could have taken. There's a multitude of states they could have taken, just like red states. I feel like they could have taken West Virginia. Would have upset that. It would
with 3 million Alabama? Votes, you can take North Dakota. Like 4-1.
Right, exactly. We're gonna go to Alabama, drop some folks off in North Dakota. Never mind Michigan and Wisconsin. But that was the premise, right? That all these guys, presumably they're guys, right? I mean, maybe they're women. I don't know. Maybe it's. I don't know who these they were supposed to be. But they vote. They probably vote in off year elections too, because they're so desperate to get their say in like a county comptroller's position. We're going to risk deportation for that. But here is Sarah Huckabee Sanders upon the closing of the commission, ostensibly because Secretary of States around the country would not provide the type of information they wanted, even though the states that had. Things were looking pretty dire. Had nothing to do with the fact that they were getting sued to share the information they had collected already.
The president still strongly feels that there was a large amount of voter fraud and attempted to do a thorough review of it, but a lot of the states didn't want to cooperate and participate. We certainly know that there were a large number of incidences reported, but we can't be sure exactly how much because we weren't able to conduct the full review that the president wanted because a number of states did not want to cooperate and refused to participate.
Okay, we certainly know that there was a large number of instances reported. Now, we don't know the totality of that because we didn't get the other information. But from the information that we have, we know that there was a large number of instances reported. Well, it turns out, and this is going to come as a shock to people, and if you are one of those folks who just are a little bit sensitive, maybe it's time for you to turn off your listening device. She was lying. Maine Secretary of State Matthew Dunlop, a Democrat who served on President Donald Trump's Voter Fraud Commission, published a trove of documents Friday. He received all those documents through his court case that he said show zero signs of mass voter fraud, declaring that the White House claims about wide-scale fraud are false. I've reviewed the documents made available to me, and they do not contain evidence of widespread voter fraud. The documents are all online now, he said, so Americans conclude for themselves the evidence to support the statements of Vice Chair Kobach and the White House regarding preliminary findings do not exist. You can see his letter online where he talks about joining the commission out of a sense of duty and in good faith. He said he
was your first mistake.
Yeah. What, how many times do I got to tell you? I'm the Scorpio. The Scorpion, I guess. I was deeply troubled by my experience on the commission and by the decision to disband it rather than comply with the law. Those concerns paled in comparison to what followed the commission's termination. Both Vice Chair Kobach and the White House made public statements claiming that the commission had uncovered widespread evidence of voter fraud. After months of litigation that should not have been necessary, I can report that statements by Vice Chair Kobach and the White House were, in fact, false. I reviewed the documents made available to me. They don't contain evidence of widespread voter fraud. The sections on evidence of voter fraud are glaringly empty.
I was going to try to come in with a defense of Sarah Huckabee Sanders, but it sounds like, was there any reports? Because I can imagine, like, because she said, certainly we know that there were a large number of incidents reported, right? Which means, like, we fomented a bunch of people to see, like, if they see a brown person voting, they'll call in and with a report.
That's possible.
Hey, she said the president feels there was voter fraud, okay? Feelings don't care about your facts.
Well, I also, you're right, and it's wrong for me to yuck on somebody's yum. I mean, if he's feeling it that way, I certainly don't want to in any way invalidate his feelings.
I saw a lot of tweets that were saying they were voter fraud. Maybe that's what she meant.
That's possible.
That's reported.
So the voter fraud commission dies. It was all a pack of lies, continues to be a pack of lies. And I'm sure this will in no way dispel any of these folks from continuing on with this fiction. However, the Kris Kobach story does not end there. So this story came out, I think, just like at the end of last week by ProPublica and the Kansas City Star. So apparently back in 2005 and 2006, Kris Kobach traveled around, I guess it was a couple of different states, but I think he went to Valley Park, Missouri. It's one of these localities. And with his help, the town of 7,000 people passed an ordinance in 2006 that punished employers for hiring illegal immigrants and landlords for renting to them. But after 2 years of litigation and nearly $300,000 in expenses, the ordinance was largely gutted. Now it's illegal only to knowingly hire illegal immigrants there, something that was already illegal under federal law. The town's attorney can't recall a single case brought under the ordinance. The former mayor of Valley Park describes Kobach's role as ambulance chasing. He characterized Kobach's attitude as, let's find a town that's got some issues or pretends to have some issues. Let's drum up an immigration problem and maybe I can advance my political position, my political thinking, and maybe make some money at the same time. Kobach used his work in Valley Park to attract other clients with disastrous effects on these municipalities. The towns ran up hefty legal costs after hiring him to defend similar ordinances. Farmers Branch, Texas, wound up owing $7 million in legal bills. Hazleton, Pennsylvania, took on debt to pay $1.4 million and eventually had to file for a state bailout. Fremont, Nebraska, had to raise property taxes to pay for Kobach's services. The guy, at the end of this, made $800,000 going around convincing these towns to pass these ordinances and then defending them in court when they were found to be illegal or unconstitutional, either on federal or state grounds. He did this over the course of 13 years. He was paid by towns and advocacy groups. It's not, I mean,
that's not that good of a return.
Well, that's his side gig.
Okay.
That's his side gig.
Nice work if you can get it.
It's nice work if you can get it. And he got to travel and made a name for himself. In June, you'll recall a federal judge handed him a sweeping courtroom defeat, overturning a Kansas law that required proof of citizenship to register to vote. The judge, if you'll recall, ordered him to attend 6 hours of continuing legal education after he repeatedly botched basic courtroom procedure. Another recent Kobach endeavor, the Federal Commission aimed at combating a voter fraud, which we just spoke of, which he co-chaired, shut down after a bevy of lawsuits challenged it, and it turns out to be completely meaningless. And Kris Kobach, well, he wins the Harold Hill Award for the day. Do we have that clip? No? Oh. Harold Hill, of course, famous, or I should say, not Harold Hill, Henry Hill, right? Harold Hill. Here he is. This is in honor of Kris Kobach, who is running for governor in Kansas in the primary tomorrow. And let's play this for him.
Should say, now, friends, let me tell you what I mean. You got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 pockets in a table. Pockets that mark the difference between a gentleman and a bum, with a capital B, and that rhymes with P, and that stands for pool. And all week long, your River City youth will be frittering away. I say your young men will be frittering. Frittering away there noontime, supper time, chore time too. Get the ball in the pocket. Never mind getting dandelions pulled, or the screen door patched, or the beefsteak pounded. Never mind pumping any water to your parents or caught with a sister.
Take that, Kris Kobach.
So apparently Republicans are rather concerned because this they feel that Kris Kobach is now so toxic that if he wins his primary in Kansas, that the governorship of Kansas is in doubt, could lose that state. And, of course, just on cue, oh, Donald Trump is going to encourage the Trumpistas to go vote for him. Kris Kobach, a strong and early supporter of mine, is running for governor of the great state of Kansas. He's a fantastic guy, loves his state and our country. He will be a great governor, has my full and total endorsement. Strong on crime, border, and military. Vote Tuesday.
He's also strong on the popular vote. I love talking to him about that.
Exactly. Now, it's going to be tough. You know, when this guy loses, you know why it will be. All the illegal immigrants came out and voted for his opponent. That is
well, at least they'll bus him to the right state this time.
Exactly. All right, should we do this? Alex Jones or Wells Fargo? Let's do this Wells Fargo before we get to Alex Jones. This is pretty funny. And I want to talk about the NRA, which is involved in a, it's claiming, it's suing Cuomo. Well, we'll get to that in a moment. But here is, now do, who is this, who is the first spokesperson here? I mean, who is the first, who is she? Is she a Fox contributor? Okay, yeah, here's the Fox News business correspondent. Now, Bill Hemmer is rumored to be looking for a White House gig. Supposedly, he's like maybe in the running for press secretary or something. So he's been particularly sort of sycophantic, if I can. Is that a right word? To Trump.
Yeah.
But here he is showing his absolute ignorance of, I don't know, one of the biggest news stories of corporate and bank malfeasance, criminality. I mean, this is just like even without even thinking about 2008. I'm talking in the past like a year, right? Like a bank had to fire 5,000 of its employees because supposedly they all went rogue and were literally signing up customers that they have at the bank who had deposits at the bank for other costly programs that they weren't aware of whatsoever. I mean, it's full on naked fraud because they had internal competitions and quotas about hitting sales points. And that's, of course, Wells Fargo. I mean, so much so. Well, we have an ad, right? Did we pull a Wells Fargo ad? All right. We'll have one to go. But here is Bill Hemmer, apparently complete. And remember, this is like the hard news guy.
Topic number three, Wells Fargo.
Wells Fargo.
Oh, they've been beaten up a lot. Come on.
Come on.
Wow, that means they've been beaten up a lot.
Pause it for one second. Is Bill Hemmer drunk? Do you think he's drunk here? Why is he like so giddy about this?
Drunk on ambition, maybe.
Maybe that's what it is. Or maybe that's what, like, that's what, as soon as you start thinking about joining the Trump administration, you have to self-medicate.
It's a funny conceit, though, coming in just with the complete wrong tone on a topic.
It's
like, come on,
weird.
They've been beaten up. Give them a break, man.
All right, let's try this again.
Topic number three, Wells Fargo.
Wells Fargo.
Oh, they've been beaten up a lot. Come on.
Come on.
Wow, that means they've been beaten up a lot.
Come
they're
on.
Trying to
they
dig
just,
themselves out of a hole. What happened
they
this time?
Just announced that there was a computer glitch, which happened in 2010 to 2015. And they're only letting us know right now that they incorrectly mishandled loans, especially foreclosures. So let's say 625 people went to go try to get a loan for their home or change the stipulations of their loan. They were incorrectly denied.
Oh.
Out of those 625, 400 had their homes foreclosed.
Not good.
So definitely not good, which is why Wells Fargo has said, hey, we're sorry, we screwed up once again because they've made fake accounts, they've overcharged for things, they've added incorrect products that you don't really need. The list goes on in terms of what Wells Fargo has done incorrectly to consumers.
It's kind of like a big oops.
It's a huge oops, and you're saying that they should be...
I'm not saying
Wells
anything.
Wells Fargo. Why do you let Wells Fargo?
He loves his red card.
Do you own the stock? Is that what?
18... I like the horse and buggy there. The logo. What,
yeah. I can see it, but
since the fake.
Did they lose their homes or not?
Yes, because this is a while ago. This happened between 2010 and 2015. So now they're going to give them $8 million for all.
Hold on.
Wow. He really does seem like he might.
Yeah. I like how babbling child is still an acceptable personality for a male newscaster to have.
Yeah, honestly, right? Man. And I mean, just the list does go on and on. The foreclosures. They got fined. They've got fined $1 billion by the Office of Comptroller of Currency and the former Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. I say former only because now they apparently don't do anything like that. For selling unnecessary products to customers. And it's not really, what did she say? Like they made mistakes. Like it's, they're breaking the law.
Incorrect things that
hurt
people. Yeah,
they've done incorrect things that like, yes, I'm sorry I hit you with that baseball bat. That was an incorrect thing for me to do. I'm sorry. Did I incorrectly take your money from your wallet and your pocket?
I don't know why Patreon doesn't let me just sign people up to new parts of Literary Hangover.
Is this one of their ads? Is this one of their new ads?
Earning back your trust.
Okay. And this is like, they're in the midst of doing this, and they are just now, almost 4 years after they discovered these computer glitches, now telling people like, oh, sorry, 400 people who lost your homes.
Well, is this even for the glitch thing? Do we know? Or is this for the previous? Is, yeah, exactly.
This is like, this is, we're going to come up with a campaign that's going to just like cover all of it. Play this.
We know the value of trust. We were built on it. Back when the country went west for gold, we were the ones who carried it back east. By steam, by horse, by iron horse. Over the years, we built on that trust. We always found the way. Until we lost it. But that isn't where the story ends.
It's where it starts again. Crank it up!
Recommit to you. Fixing what went wrong, making things right, and ending product sales goals for branch bankers. So we can focus on your satisfaction.
Yeah.
We're holding ourselves accountable to find and fix issues proactively.
Give me a break.
Because earning back your trust is our greatest priority.
We're fixing issues.
It's a new day at Wells Fargo.
Do you know what fixing like issues... Stop. It's not. I don't give a shit anymore. We're fixing problems proactively. In other words, we're not going to consciously steal from you. That's what we're going to do. We're going to head ourselves off at the pass. I love the whole like sort of like passive voice.
Things went wrong. Mistakes were made. Yeah, you know what went wrong? Obama didn't nationalize the fuck out of you.
Exactly.
Shout out to the Black Keys for that backing track.
There. Is that who it
is? Who it was? Yeah.
Of course it was. Of course. You know, they actually had a sellout off with Vampire Weekend on Colbert Report once. It was amusing.
I'm not sure I know what that means.
Like, who's the bigger sellout?
Oh, that's pretty
good. The Black Keys.
I think they won. They definitely won with this.
I something's going on with Bill Hemmer. There was something really off.
11:30, Fox News. Sounds about right. On
super
time.
Excited about, like, come on! You getting on? Do you haven't checked the commercials?
Like the Orson Buggy.
They're taking it up again. They're kicking it up a notch. They're getting proactively honest.
He's like a advertising guy or marketing guy that shows up to the Wells Fargo pitch. Like, what's working for us? Look at the horse and buggy, right? Like, that's good. Yeah. People like that.
Unbelievable. All right. So this is interesting. And I got to be honest with you. I'm not sure how I feel about this. So Alex Jones now, he has not been completely deplatformed, but iTunes is no longer carrying his podcast. Facebook has pulled down, I guess, 4 of his pages. Spotify has pulled his podcast, but Spotify is... I don't know where else you can get his podcast. You probably can serve it directly. I honestly don't know what I feel about this. I mean, I know what I feel about Alex Jones. And ostensibly, iTunes has said, Apple does not tolerate hate speech. We have clear guidelines that creators and developers must follow to ensure that we provide a safe environment for all our users. Like, I don't know how you can justify like carrying like Laura Ingraham's show. Yeah. Right? I mean,
I think the Daily Showa is on a bunch of these platforms still.
5 of the 6 InfoWars podcasts have been removed. They ostensibly violate their guidelines. Part of the problem is that places like Facebook, iTunes are monopolies. And they have not just too much power from a corporate side, but it's also, it makes things like this more problematic, right? Because if there's no other mechanism for him to get, to pump out his bullshit, it's a little bit of a problem. and I'm not quite clear where this ends. And it's not like this isn't going to help his business. I mean, he's going to be fine. It's not going to go away. It's not, whatever the goals are not going to be met by this. And they're certainly not doing it. Apple and Facebook and Spotify, they're not doing it because they came to this on their own. They're doing it because of pressure. And I understand. And in the main, I don't have an issue with like saying don't advertise on this thing or whatnot. But when you are the distribution mechanism and it's so consolidated, and I have a feeling the solution is to have less consolidated distribution mechanisms, which means that we need to start thinking about antitrust for all of these monopolies of distribution. But when you're the distribution mechanism, I think it starts to get pretty problematic. Maybe you could demonetize, but to silence in that way is a little bit, I mean, look, here, and this gets back to, you know, my time with Mike Cernovich and even the James Gunn. At one point, these corporations that are involved in disseminating or providing the vehicle for dissemination of this type of content and news organizations, because they're in the business of assessing reality on some level, right? And presenting it back to us. Everybody's going to have to just start exercising their brains a little bit more, right? We're still coming out of an era where there's this notion of, which was always false, but there was this pretense of objectivity. And the right was very effective for a long time in making media entities in particular and corporations bend over backwards not to allow reality to in any way impose upon them, right? Like, you can't call me racist even though I have a problem with black people, because that's the worst thing you can say to somebody. And then you have media organizations which I would say are, broadly speaking, more sympathetic or more simpatico, I should say, with, broadly speaking, not necessarily the political agenda of liberalism, but just sort of like the broad notion of being liberal. And they bend over backwards to sort of cater to these morons. And the problem is that they did so while still trying to maintain some type of objective facade. But I think it's like at one point these entities are going to have to step up and say, you know what? We can assess things. If Sam Cedar writes a tweet in response to an attempt to allow Roman Polanski to get a Lifetime Achievement Award, despite the fact that he's a convicted on the run statutory rapist who ran from the country because he was afraid that he was going to get a bad plea deal from the judge, or the judge didn't accept the plea deal. And he writes a piece of satire that says, I will say it again because I'm not embarrassed by it, I don't care about Roman Polanski. This is from memory, but I think it was, I don't care about Roman Polanski. But if my daughter is ever raped, I hope it's by a much older man with a great sense of mise-en-scène. No one who knows what the words mise-en-scène mean would have any mistake in interpreting what that tweet was meant to project, right? People don't say like, hey, he said that time flies. I don't know, you know, like time doesn't fly. He's lying. No, it's an idiom. And if you can understand an idiom, you can understand satire. People have to step up. And by people, I mean corporations are going to have to do this, particularly if you're in the content business. And if you're news media, you have to step up and you have to make an assessment. Despite the fact that there may be people who are clamoring on either side of anything and make a determination as to what it is. In other words, like if you make it about a broad policy, instead of like your ability to assess because you're afraid of being pegged a righty or a lefty or whatnot, you're just going to be in this quicksand. The reason why you deplatform Alex Jones is because he's spreading disinformation as if it was news. And I know that people are like, well, we can't. Who are we to say what news is? You know what? You're an entity that says what news is. And if you lose customers, good. There should be multiple of these platforms. That's the only way this is going to work going forward. Because this isn't going to work. This is just going to keep. It's going to be haphazard. It's going to be, they're going to be there. These companies are playing politics. And what they should just do is like, we make an assessment about what reality is and we stand by it. And we should, that's why there should be multiple Facebooks. That's why there should be multiple platforms for podcasts so that people, if they have a disagreement with that, then that's fine. I mean, you know, I don't know. There is no solution to Fox News, which is full of crap. There is no solution. You can't say to cable carriers, don't carry them. Right? Because they carry the Sci-Fi Channel. And none of that stuff is real either. That's all. I got news for you. The Sci-Fi Channel, almost 100% of the programming, is completely fictional.
I think X-Files is more real than people like to think.
But that's the problem that we have. We just, these entities are going to have to make assessments. And people are going to have to learn to either like say like, oh, this company makes assessments that are rational and grounded. News companies are going to have to make assessments. That's why they have all those resources, right? I mean, ostensibly, it's to let us know about our world. And you have to be able to say, Alex Jones is, it's crap. And this is satire, and that is not satire. Like, the idea of good faith has to actually be a little less squishy. Alex Jones is not delivering the truth as he thinks it is. Alex Jones is delivering bullshit. And sometimes it's incredibly offensive and destructive. And so a company should be able to say, we're just not going to platform him. But there should be other opportunities for him to get platformed by other crappy companies.
I can't help but think about when people like Mark Zuckerberg maybe 8 years ago talked about how disruptive and amazing the types of things their platforms were going to do for society. And now it's sort of like, oh, shit, what have we actually done? And now we need to fix problems and we have a much more humble tasks ahead of us. And
yeah, except for what he was really interested in. We're going to make a ton of cash.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. They're going to get all of the media outlets dependent on Facebook for traffic and then ransom it back to them. And now they're changing their formula so that you can't even buy back your traffic that you used to have from Facebook. Like they have, call me crazy, but like, I don't think it's a good idea for a single private company to have control over the entire fourth estate.
Absolutely.
You're crazy, James.
And this is, I mean, ultimately this is why we've got to break up things like Facebook and the way that you do it. I mean, I maybe we'll have somebody on to talk about how one would do that, but there are, everybody has ideas. You can disaggregate parts of it. You can have regulations in terms of what can be linked and what can't be linked. I mean, this is going to have to happen, folks, because the brave new world is really not turning out so good.
I vote expropriate, but that's probably not a surprise.
Right. But I think like you could cut it up into to small enough purposes that in some ways you are expropriating the value, at least a huge chunk of the value, and you're disseminating it and you're reassigning it. I mean, look, they did it with the phone company.
Yeah, there is certainly a case for nationalizing infrastructure. Like, that's not necessarily a communist idea.
We do it. I mean, we've done it with we're doing it on some level with steel, right? I mean, that's not necessarily a taking in that instance. But all right, here is this is Vic Berger's compilation of Alex Jones, just to remind you of just how sort of despicable he is.
All I know is psychopaths operate. They're not human. I don't like them. Okay. You know, I don't want this to have ever happened, but I wish it was real instead of fake. That is 100 times more scary. Sandy Hook is a synthetic, completely fake, with actors, in my view, manufactured. It's more than these dead poor children's eyes. You got to go with your gut, man. My gut tells me. I've never felt this freaked out. And it just is the fakest thing since the $3 bill. And you better get ready for more of it, folks.
Anderson Cooper turns. He's supposedly there at Sandy Hook in front of the memorial, and his whole forehead and nose blurs out. Anderson Cooper has got some explaining to do, because I know blue screen when I see it.
They clearly used actors. I mean, they even ended up using photos of kids killed in mass shootings here in a fake mass shooting in Turkey. So, yeah. Or Pakistan.
I will sit there on the air and look at every position and play devil's advocate.
Was that devil's advocate? The whole thing is a giant hoax. The whole thing was fake.
The Sandy Hook hoax.
The whole thing was fake.
Yes, because I remember even that day, if I go back from memory, then saying, but then some of it looks like it's real. But then what do you do when they've got the kids going in circles in and out of the building with their hands up? I've watched the footage, and it looks like a drill.
Walking in circles, in and out.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, this guy is a malignant force. He's a scourge. And so in that respect, I think it's fine. But we do have a bigger problem. And really, it's basically just going to have to become down where people are going to have to make assessments, and we're going to have to break up these platforms and make them not as important. So the idea of a platform saying, "Hey, we don't want to be associated with this," is not that big of a deal for that person or that entity. And people who want some semblance of reality will congregate in one place. And people who want that type of stuff, they'll go and find it. And that happens in society all the time, right? I mean, before we had an internet, if you want to read garbage magazines, you could read garbage magazines. You just go and pick it up. And when you buy it, it's self-contained.
And also on the other end of the spectrum, maybe some public grants for actual journalism are in order, because it's been really hard to watch my industry get completely destroyed by the market. And, you know, if we are in an info war and there is some public value in having accurate news sources out there, then we got to do something about it.
Of course. And I think the more you break that stuff up, then the less concerning any possible legitimate concerns about a so-called state-run media or a state paid for media go out the window if you have a dozen other outlets.
And people act like we don't have like state run media. If you watch a local news report, half the stories are just press releases from the local police department.
Yes, or from corporations.
Right.
All right, we're going to take a quick break, head into the fun half. We've got a lot more stuff to talk about. This NRA lawsuit against Andrew Cuomo. Governor Nixon is doing a great job in pursuing very progressive policies. And how Trump's tariffs are benefiting, this is going to come as a shock, some of Trump's buddies in big steel. They're actually, this is how they're going to get rid of their competitors in this country. All that and more in the fun half. Just a reminder, this program relies on your support. You can become a member today by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. Once you do, we say thank you by giving you extra content every day. You don't have to listen to it. You can listen to the free show without the ads. Sometimes people get bummed out by the ads. Members, of course, can access all the ad information by reading it. They'll just go and check it out. But jointhemajorityreport.com just costs a couple of bucks a week. And you can make sure this show keeps on humming. Of course, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY, get 10% off. And also, tomorrow's Tuesday. Whoa, what? That's pretty good. Don't forget to check out the Michael Brooks Show on iTunes or on our YouTube channel. And wow, the Intifada is a pretty cool logo now.
Thank you. My friend Debbie designed it.
Hic Rhodus, Hic Salta. What does that mean?
Here is the rose, now you dance. It's like an obscure Marxist reference.
All right. And there, I'm looking at one of those videos. It looks pretty good. Globalist Uprising with Brandon Jordan. That's episode 16. Is that right?
What?
That's episode 16.
It is indeed.
All right.
We have a YouTube channel now, as Matt just showed you, and we've got all our episodes up on there. We're working on getting some video content too, like actual videos that you can watch. Sean might have to mask up or something, but
I don't want to hear anymore.
We just recorded a very special episode with Matt Crisman in Virgil, Texas, of Chapo Trap House, and that should be out very soon.
Sounds good. And Matt, what's the latest on Literary Hangover? Wow, look at everybody's got their own little... That's great.
The Maypole of Marymount. Are you familiar with the Maypole in Quincy, Massachusetts? What was Mount Wollaston or Marymount?
No.
No? Well, this would be for you. This is some mass history that you are unaware of. It's actually Thomas Morton was a member of the Wollaston Company, and a lot of his people went on to Virginia, but he stayed and made it like this amazing place where you can do like these pagan rituals. The key advantage was it was good for trade because the Puritans were sort of an ethno-state. They no race mix in there. You could race mix in Marymount, and wow, it was a trade advantage, and that's why the Puritans had to put an end to it. So we talk about that and Nathaniel Hawthorne.
Check that out, folks. Patreon.com, Literary Hangover. All right, quick break. Head into the fun half. 646-257-3920 is the number. We'll be right back in one moment. Jamie and I may have a disagreement.
Yeah, you can't just say whatever you want about people just because you're rich.
I have an absolute right to mock them on YouTube.
He's up there buggy whipping like he's the boss.
I am not your employer.
You know, I'm tired of the negativity.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to upset you. You're nervous. You're a little bit upset. You're riled up.
Yeah, maybe you should rethink your defense of that, you fucking idiots.
We're just going to get rid of you.
All right.
But dude.
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 You want to smoke this joint?
Yes.
Do you feel like you are a dinosaur?
Some good shit.
Exactly. I'm happy now.
It's a win-win.
It's a win-win-win.
Oh, hell yeah.
Now listen to me. 2, 3, 4, 5 times. 847-906-501-457. 2, 38, 56, 27. 1/2. 5/8. 3.9 billion.
Wow.
He's the ultimate math nerd.
Don't you see?
Why don't you get a real job instead of spewing vitriol and hatred, you left-wing Limbaugh?
Everybody's taking their dumb juice today.
Come on, Sammy.
Dance, dance, dance.
Ooh. Grandpa.
I had my first post-coital scene with a woman. I'm hoping to add more moves to my repertoire. All I have is the dip and the swirl.
Fine, we can double dip.
Yes, this is a perfect moment.
No.
Wait, what?
You make under $1 million a year. You're scum. You're nothing.
Excuse me? Fuck you, you fucking liberal elite. I think you belong in jail.
Thank you for saying that, Sam. You're a horrible, despicable person.
All right, gonna take a quick break. I want to take a moment to talk to some of the libertarians out there. Take whatever vehicle you want to drive to the library,
What you're talking about is jibber jabber.
Classic. I'm feeling more chill already.
Good. Donald Trump can kiss all of our asses.
Hey, Sam. Hey, Andy. You guys ready to do some evil?
Hitler was such an idiot.
I think I might be a Nazi.
Agreed.
No.
Death to America.
Do.
Yes.
Wow.
Wow, that's weird. No way! Unbelievable. This guy's got a really good hook.
Throw our hands up.
Ooh.
Wow.
But Sam, I gotta get off.
No worries. Let's. I want to just flesh this out a little bit. I mean, look, it's a free speech issue. If you don't like me,
hey, shut up.
Thank you for calling into the Majority Report. Sam will be with you shortly.